everyone to Desperado Talks. We are a portion of the Desperado LGBTQ Film Festival here in Phoenix, and we are hosted by Paradise Valley Community College and also the Maricopa County Community College District. They are our major sponsors, and they've been supportive of our organization and our film festival for 11 years now. Also, one of our major supporters and sponsors is Phoenix Pride. So we thank all three of you guys for being there for us and for allowing us this opportunity to hold these conversations. So the title of this conversation is Out to Pasture, LGBT Seniors and Aging. Now, I look at everybody here, and you're not all seniors, I can tell. We're all very youthful humans. So, but many of us have a connection to the LGBT senior community, either as a film producer or as a VP of an assisted living place or as an elder lawyer, as an activist and musician. So that's the story about the festival and the organization of this. These are being filmed in early October, and they'll be showing them during the festival October 22nd through the 31st. And following that, they will be available on Desperado's YouTube channel. It's a private YouTube channel. So here we go. First of all, let's start with just a really short introduction for all of us. I'll go first, and then Alan will go last, and otherwise we'll take you guys kind of alphabetically, if that's all right. Everybody likes that? Okay. All right, good. So my name is Julie Roberts. I live here in Phoenix. I work with the Desperado Film Festival and have for about 9 years, and love every minute of it. I also lived in Japan and worked a lot with the international lesbian community there, and you know, came out as a lesbian separatist, which we won't talk about today, but it's a pretty big deal back then. And then after that 6 or 8 years that I was there, I moved to San Francisco, lived there for a few years. My partner and I started an LGBTQ inbound travel company, which worked for several years on that. It was a lot of fun and good things. And then we moved down here to Phoenix in 2003. At that point, I started working for Equality Arizona, which is an LGBTQ advocacy and education organization. And then started working with Maricopa Community Colleges in their foundation and did fundraising for it. An out and up scholarship, which was for disenfranchised LGBTQ youth. So that's kind of how I got involved with Alan and this festival. And I had to retire for medical reasons about 6 years ago, but I've never given up Desperado. Once a year, the guys call me and I go on. There we go. So that's me, Julie. Okay, so let me go on to the next person, I guess, is Cid. Would you tell us about yourself?
I'm Cid Bullens, and I am a singer-songwriter musician. I'm living in Nashville at the moment, though I'm from New England, Massachusetts, and Maine. And I am a featured artist in the film Invisible, which is being directed by T.J. Parsell. And I'm a trans man. The reason I'm in this particular group is because I am an elder, I guess. I like that word better than old person. And I transitioned at 61 years old. T.J. Parsell came to see my one person show and in 2018 in Nashville, which I had written about my life, asked me to be in the one of the artists featured in Invisible. I will tell you that my, just as a short thing, that I sang with Elton John as Cindy. I was Cindy Bullens, and I sang with Elton John back in the mid 70s. I sang on the Grease movie soundtrack, three lead vocals. I had my own solo career as Cindy Bullens and was nominated for a Grammy or two back in the late 70s and early 80s. And then kind of bowed out, got married, had kids, bowed out of the business, and came back later in the 90s and after a personal tragedy, and which spurred me back into the to writing songs. And here I am today. And thanks to TJ for getting me back and putting me in the film.
Dave Ragan, you want to give us a little bit about you?
Sure. Thank you, Julie. Again, my name is Dave Ragan, and I am now Senior Vice President of Resident Services at Beatitudes Campus in Phoenix. And I think what makes us distinctive is we are a single site, meaning we're just, we're not a big corporation, nonprofit. We have independent living, which I oversee, and a lot of the services that go with us, about 400 in independent living folk, about 100 in our assisted living, and about 100 in memory care and skilled nursing and so on and so forth. So we're a growing community. Let's see, I also am a United Church of Christ minister, so I've served local churches here in the Valley for quite some time. In the 90s, became one of the first churches to become open and affirming, and then helped co-found a group called No Longer Silent Clergy for Justice, which we were speaking out against the religious right and all their anti-LGBT rhetoric. And so we continue to take those same stances as a faith-based United Church of Christ entity here at Beatitudes Campus. So that's a little bit about me.
Okay, great. So next, Helene, step in.
Okay, I'm Helene Wenzel. I am Brooklyn born and bred, but left there at the age of 21. And I've been living in California and Cambridge several periods of time. I call them my former life and my current life. The first thing that I did was I was professor of French and women's studies, and I got a PhD at Berkeley, and I taught at San Francisco State, and then I moved east to Cambridge, and I taught at Yale, which was a bit of a trip, literally. And in Cambridge, I met my spouse, Abby, who stuck her head in here, and we moved to California in 1990. When I started law school, and I finished law school in 1994. We got married in 2004, and those were voided. we got married again in 2008 on July 9th. And that was a period between June 17th and something like November 11th, during which about 18,000 couples married in California, not all Californians, but people flocked from north and south and east and west. And those then Prop 8 was voted on, and so marriage stopped dead in November sometime. We had friends who were about to get married the next day because it was the anniversary of when they met, and that took care of that, so they could not get married until later. And so after Prop 8, those 18,000 couples, we remained married under California law, state law anyway, and so that was that. When I became a lawyer, I heard about elder law just really by accident at a meeting in another law school. And I thought, that sounds interesting. My folks are getting older. Well, they were old. I've sort of moved into it myself. But and there was like, you know, how do you navigate legal systems and all this nonsense? Because I had had a friend whose mother had been on Medicaid in New York and what, you know, the whole hassle of trying to get services, the legal hassle. So I decided that I would do elder law, and then I opened myself up to a larger proportion of my clients at that time were LGBT. At that time, and before marriage became possible, or domestic partnership even, the legal landscape was kind of limited for us, and there were things that you had to do in order to kind of survive. And so that's part of what I've been doing. Everything changed, of course. Well, everything changed in some ways when same-sex marriage became legal. We still have other things that we need, other issues that need attending, even though we can get married. And that's, you know, it's something, but not everything.
Mm-hmm. Great, thanks. Stu, can you come in and tell us about you?
Sure. My name is Stu Maddux. My spouse and I have a what's called a social enterprise. We make social impact documentaries. We take an issue, highlight it, and take it into communities to affect change starting by raising awareness and then We have tools for each issue that go along with the film. And we had the privilege of screening a film several years ago called Gen Silent about LGBT aging at Desperado, and met many of you folks. And it's a privilege to be here again today to talk a little bit about what's happened since that time. The film is about 10 years old, and it was about older folks going back into the closet because the care system was so unculturally competent, was so it was so worrisome to enter into that it was easier for many of us just to hide our lives. That's changed, but in some ways, and in some ways it hasn't. And I think that's what we're here to talk about. It led to other films that we're doing, but at the core of our business is LGBT documentary filmmaking. So good to be here.
Thanks, Stu. And TJ, I'm gonna let you bring in the end there.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for inviting me to the panel. My name's TJ Parsell. I'm a filmmaker and author and a human rights activist. And I say the human rights activist last, but most importantly, because film and even my book was about putting a human face on an issue, and all of my work is about changing hearts and minds. So a lot of my work prior to the film that brings me to Desperado, which is Invisible Gay Women in Southern Music, a lot of my work prior to that was on LGBT prisoner rights and sexual safety behind bars. So I've done a lot of work in that arena. Our film, Invisible Gay Women in Southern Music, is a profile of a group of women and as they've navigated the male-dominated, heteronormative industry of country music. Most of my subjects are in their 60s and 70s. We just won the Silver Image Award from AARP for profiling subjects and names of individuals who are over 50. That's what we're about.
That's great. So Alan, you want to close out for us?
Congratulations, TJ. That sounds exciting.
Thank you very much.
Fantastic.
Yeah, we're very pleased.
Yeah, I bet. My name's Alan East. I am the film programmer, festival programmer for the Desperado LGBTQ Film Festival. I am an Arizona State graduate. Lived in Phoenix for a long time. I happen to live in California now, but I'm still very involved with the film festival. And I've been kind of involved in more cultural kind of activism all my life. That's kind of been my focus, but I'm interested today to find out how LGBTQ senior issues have changed over, 30, 40 years, and see where we're going. So I just want to say thanks to everybody for being here.
Thank you, everyone. You all sound fascinating. So. Dinner sounds good to me. I'm just trying to figure out where to start this, and it's because it's huge. We've been around forever. We're going to be around forever. Where does this conversation start? And I think that it's going to have to start at Stonewall, just in terms of a point of reference. And so that's 50 years ago, because I think the progress that we've made in the last 50 years is great. I mean, and I think that the thing too is that so many of us now are 50 years older than we were back then when that happened. So just want to cap in a little bit of the events, and I know everybody knows them, but I'm just going to say, started with Stonewall, and then, then we all started saying, hey, we've got some rights. And then we started Pride. The first Pride march in New York was just a year after Stonewall. And that's where it really kind of all started. And we're proud, we're here, we're proud, we're not going to go back. And that was so huge, and that kept on for a while. But then I think the thing that really kind of put a big damper on us was when the AIDS epidemic started. I know it affected me greatly. I was in the theater, and let's face it, an entire generation of creative males were gone. They were just gone. And that took so much energy. It took so much energy with the gay community. It took so much energy with the lesbian community, supportive of that. And then, I can't even begin to talk about the closets that the trans community was hiding in. It was huge. So then, we kind of got through that. We kind of came on. And then a lot of things happened a lot, I think. I think that, they found medicine for AIDS. You know, we had got domestic partnerships in a lot of organizations and companies and states. Then there's the Matthew Shepard hate crime bill. That was a huge thing that came in to help protect us. And once it protected us, then those of us who were afraid to come out were able to come out even more. And then here we are, we all have marriage equality since what, 2014, you know, but I'm sure there's other places to go. I mean, I think that one of the things that we're gonna discuss here is those of us who are wanna go into to live a nice life out to pasture, which is not really what we want. Sid's laughing at me because I know he said, I don't like that title. But it was tongue in cheek just a little bit, because I think not a single person in this conversation is gonna be going out to pasture. But we have to say that there are people that need that and want that, and how can we help that happen for them?
Well, before there was marriage, domestic partnership, et cetera, same-sex couples had a lot to do in terms, you know, legally to bind together in some ways and not have parents of a deceased gay partner come in and grab all the stuff out of the house and say, it doesn't belong to you, you're nobody. And this happens with straight people who are also, you know, together but not married. But what we did, what I was doing at the beginning was making sure that the documents were in place that would create as close as we could, you know, to having legal rights to each other's lives. And the most important documents were the powers of attorney, which are only effective while you're alive. But should you, you know, walk off a curb and get hit by a car and go into a hospital, there's no one to sign you out. And you can end up in a conservatorship in California. So that was one of the first things to do, is to make sure that, you know, the people who came to me were going to be safe in that way. Marriage kind of changed that for the people who are married, but there are many, many, many people who are not married. So the difference between being a couple and, you know, and a married couple and being single, the differences are great. The issues that we face are pretty much the same. You know, there's health and finances, end of life, real property, and the difference between being single and being same sex but not married and same sex married are all the government goodies that married people get and have always gotten. For example, Social Security, you can get your partner's Social Security. As a spouse, you have rights to employment and retirement funds that you wouldn't have. You get tax breaks. You can go into assisted living and places like that, you know, comfortably if you want to. I mean, my mother was at a great congregate living space. Nobody talked to anybody or about anybody who was gay. I visited her often, and I could see that there were some gay men there, but they did not make anything of it, and neither did anybody else. And that was kind of sad. This is a pretty middle to high end place. Everybody was educated, but it was just not spoken. And I was very aware of that, also aware because my mother did not come out for me, and I had to do it one by one to the people whom she was friendly with there. Mm-hmm. So a major issue has always been adoption. Gay parents who either perhaps one of them, you know, a lesbian or a gay man had a child, and you want to bring them into the family, and, you know, we had to go get parent, second parent, all kinds of papers and legal documents. Now you're married and you can just sort of marry your parents, same sex parents, but it doesn't matter. You both have the same legal rights to your children and responsibilities for that matter. I think what the future holds is as we age, we will be going into these kinds of places. And you've mentioned cultural competency a lot. And this is what we find. I have done some talks at different places, you know, assisted living and other congregate living, talking about cultural competency, that people who are the caregivers, medical personnel, anybody who, you know, you come in contact with in those situations, to understand who they're dealing with. And that if we create some cultural competency among the people who are not LGBT, then those of us who are can fit in and feel much more comfortable going. And Dave, I've visited a couple of places in California. We do have Fountain Grove, which billed itself as the first, you know, LGBT. And I think still the population is not as great, you know, it's more straight than it is LGBT, but definitely that's what goes on. There are parties for Pride and there are flags all over the place. And it's definitely, and it's high end. So that makes a difference too, because if you don't have the money to be high end, you're kind of stuck in places that might not, in fact, be looking for, you know, to make you comfortable. What else did I want to talk about? Just a bit. What I insist upon with clients now, well, I should say this. People are coming to me and saying, should we get married? And it's like, okay, let me list, you know, the 12 things that you have unmarried and the 1,011 or something that you have if you're married. We also have domestic partnerships. And I had a talk the other day with a colleague who said domestic partnership in California is ridiculous. I mean, yes, you have all these states' rights, but you're not getting into the federal stuff. So you might as well, you know, go for broke and get married. Because I have a couple now where they're afraid to marry because one woman's health is totally, totally compromised. And the other one is afraid of being financially responsible, which is another interesting point. We so wanted to be married. And then when we got married, we discovered that taxes and all kinds of things change, and you have responsibilities as well as all the wonderful things that came along with marriage. So, you know, the first time that we filed, you could file as partners, or you could file separately, you know, married but separate. And the first year that taxes were being done, all the accountants in the greater Bay Area kind of were going nuts. They had so much work to do to learn it. It was such a learning curve. One woman got so overwhelmed that she ended up having to leave the state because she really wasn't serving her clients very well. You know, everybody said, go here. And everybody went there. And then it was like, I know some of the couples who had their taxes done by her and they had them redone, you know, amended a couple of years later. Legally, there's stuff that has yet to be done. And that's in terms of financial and health and, you know, all the major places, housing, which I won't even talk about, but it's a very big one.
Sid, can I bring you in now? I'd like to hear, you know, what the complexities and the difficulties. I know you've been married in a straight marriage before, and now you've done a lot of changes, gone through a lot of changes. How is life better now? Are things different now? What's happening?
Very interesting. Well, my life is interesting, but yes, I was married for 22 years to a gay man as a woman. So that's a whole nother subject. But it was a straight marriage. We did try to fit into that mold. I bore two babies, you know, myself. But as a trans man and as an older trans man, I want to say, you know, in point to some of the things that have been stated, that I have a fear of getting sick, you know, and going to the hospital. You know, every time I walk into a dentist or a doctor's office, a new one, I have, you know, because I moved from Maine to Nashville. And there's always this apprehension, you know, and I pass, you know, I'm lucky. I'm a trans man and I'm married to a woman, but and I am married to a woman. But I'm a trans man and I pass. But there are so many of us, trans women, older trans women, for example, who have a more difficult time. And as a trans person, I not only have apprehension for myself, but I think we are, trans people, are kind of down on the totem pole, if you will, of understanding and of acceptance. And And as Stu is alluding to, I think we've gone backwards a little bit as we've gone forward, you know, this separation we have, at least in the United States right now, and people just kind of going, I don't want to deal with that. But personally, I had a father who had Alzheimer's disease, you know, so I am concerned, you know, if I get sick, if I have issues, you know, my wife, who's younger, 14 years younger than me, is she going to be responsible for my health? Of course, you know, is she going to have the money to take care of me? Will there be a place for me to go? And if there is, how am I going to be treated? You know? So I know I've run the gamut there of things, but as a trans person, I do have these concerns, both personally and for my community, about and my mission, bring it back to personal, in this world now as an elder. I am a musician, I'm a singer-songwriter, I've had a career, all of that stuff, but my mission now as a trans man and as a public figure is to be more of an activist, and with my story, going out there and hopefully opening some people's minds to the fact that being a transgender person is a human condition and not something that should be feared or othered, you know.
Right. Thanks a lot for that. Stu,
I'm just curious, do you find that your situation is in Nashville, are you there for creating music, recording music, being an artist, or is that where you retired to? I mean, what was?
No, I'm not retired. There's no such thing as retirement for an artist, you know,
absolutely.
Creative person. I've tried to retire, it just doesn't work, because I keep thinking of things that I want to do.
Right.
And people like TJ keep pulling me out of obscurity, my own obscurity in my own mind. But I'm in Nashville this is my third time living here in 20 years,
okay.
30 years, actually. I love the community. It is a creative community. And I have friends like TJ, and we keep each other, we poke each other a lot creatively and personally, you know, I have friends here, and it is a creative community. As a trans person, now I was considered a gay woman, even though I had been married during some of the time. I am a songwriter. I did come here in 1990 and commuted here to be a Nashville songwriter, which is why I'm involved in the gay women in Southern music, which Invisible is, that's the subtitle. And so I am a songwriter and I have worked here. And I was a little concerned coming back here as a trans person, because it's a little bit, as I explained, it's a little different. But it is a progressive city. It is a red state. It is a conservative state, but we are a progressive community. And I actually, I feel safe in my community here.
Mm-hmm. Sid just segued into the Nashville, and I guess the lesbian singer-songwriter situations. And tell us a little bit about your film. I think only myself and maybe David have seen it. So, and by the way, it's beautiful.
Oh, well,
so,
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You can tell us a little bit about it.
Sure. Invisible is about a group of gay women and one trans man. We actually dropped the subtitle for a little bit, but then we added it back so people could see what the film was about. Mm-hmm. But we dropped it so that we could include Sid's story, because he brought so much to it, because here was someone who lived both sides of the gender line, both and experienced the country music industry, both as a female and a male. But basically it's their journeys through this very this environment that is not very tolerant of anyone who's different. You know, I had a friend of mine come to me a couple of years ago and say, TJ, I got this great idea for a film. In fact, I had just moved to Nashville. And the friend called me up and he said, you want to have coffee? I got this great idea for a film. And I said, okay, what do you got? And he says, gay women and country music. There's this entire network of gay women songwriters. They've written for everybody. And many of them are my friends. And I thought, wow. And within 3 weeks, we were interviewing Mary Gaucher. And then Jess Leary came on board. And Jess said, oh, Mary did it, I'll do it. And Bonnie Baker came on board. And Kai Fleming followed. I mean, these are women who have written for everyone. One of our artists has written so many number one hits, she doesn't know how many she's written. So their catalogs were intriguing, but for me, what was more interesting was their journeys and how did they navigate this industry that, as I said, is not very tolerant to anyone who's different. And it resonated for me because I remember back in the 80s and 90s, I was in the software business and I couldn't be out. My job was to build relationships talking about my boyfriend was not going to be building a lot of relationships. And particularly given who my audience was, they were middle-aged, heterosexual white men that lived in the suburbs for the most part, IT directors and whatnot. So I knew personally what that journey was like in terms of having to play the pronoun game, the stress of hiding, the not being my authentic self. And so that to me was what I thought was really rich. And I think most people that are our age and older have had to deal with this in one way or another. And some of the women in our film, they're very self-effacing. They were saying, look, there's no closet big enough for this, you know, what we call in the trade, the obvious ones. And then there were others that did hide and did pay that cost. And we go a lot deeper than you would think. I mean, their catalogs were just qualifiers to participate in the film. And I think that ultimately it's an indictment of the patriarchy of country music. We uncovered a lot of stuff in there. It's funny because when we got the AARP award, I kind of was struck for a moment. I was saying, oh yeah, I guess we are all old, aren't we?
We're card-carrying members of AARP.
That's exactly right. And Invisible was, kind of one of our subjects had written a song called Invisible. She wrote it for her daughter, for her son who was being bullied. And Hunter Hayes, it was a big number one hit. Hunter Hayes debuted it at the Grammys. And she and her son rented a suite at the Omni to watch this film that was really addressing being a bully. But I think that, the term invisible, it's like any of us who have aged have kind of had to feel what that feels like to become invisible. I mean, our community is so youth oriented. And I think that, when you suggested this topic about out to pasture, I had the same reaction Cidney did about, well, I'm not ready to go out to pasture. I'm dying with my boots on. I'm just getting started. I went to film school at 50. I heard somebody say once that, if you live long enough, life will teach you how to live it. And I think that, particularly for us artists, as we get older, we have more to say. To tie back to your thing that you brought up, Julie, at the beginning of your talk about how we've come so far in terms of LGBT rights. I mean, we've seen such change. As we're out on the festival circuit with Invisible and we're playing in 27 cities. Mm-hmm. And I am flabbergasted. I was in LA and when I went through West Hollywood, it was like Disneyland with lights up and go-go boys in the windows at the light. I had people honking at me, and Chicago, I'm in Chicago now and Boys Town is, like banners and, the streets are, it's beyond anything that I think we ever could have dreamed of, when we started marching or when we got really angry during the 80s because our family, our community, our friends were dying and nobody was doing anything about it. And we realized silence was death. I think you know, one of the themes that comes through in our film very strongly is one of our artists say, you know, we all stand on the shoulders of giants. And I think that the younger people today, the younger artists in the country music industry today are coming into a place where there is a lot of opportunity and promise. And they owe a lot of that to, you know, the seniors that came before them that you know, fought those battles.
Right, you're so right about that. I'd like to, I mean, we're kind of getting sort of close to our ending time. So what I'd like to put forth again is one more question, which is, okay, we've lived our lives so far, thus far, whatever you want to do. None of us are over yet. I know this to be true. But what is it what's affected you the most in the last 50 years, and what needs to be done? Maybe we can't do it, but maybe what we need to do is to tell those young people or let them know, where do you get to go from here? You know, where are we going to go from here? And so if you can think about that for me, I had a chance to think about it. So I'm going to say mine first, and then I'll encompass all of you and let you do so. I think that the things that's the most, I don't want to say irritating to me, but the most difficult thing for me to accept was what they called employment inequality and housing inequality. And I was with Equality Arizona for a long time. And when marriage equality started coming up as the thing to do, and it was being, you know, put forth by HRC and all the other national organizations, I said, you know what, marriage is good. I want people to be able to be married if they want to, but some of us don't want to, like me. And some of us who don't want to still need to have protections to be able to keep our jobs, keep our houses, you know, all of those things that stuff's just not quite there yet. And then to be able to, you know, be able to move, go into our senior living places or wherever. I was always appalled that, like, you know, if you were gay and you worked for American Express for a while, you worked for them and you went and you got married with your partner and you came back and you put your wedding pictures on your desk and everything was fun and great. And people, oh, who's that? And you say, oh, that's me and my wife. We just got married. Oh, you're a lesbian? Oh, well, you're fired. Or, you know, you wanted to move into an apartment. They didn't have to give you an apartment. At least it's here. That's true in Arizona. They don't have to let you have an apartment, and they don't have to tell you why. And so those are the things I want to be able to be just like everybody else. I was married for a long time. I had heterosexual privilege like Sid, you know, and I want the same privilege for myself now as a lesbian as I had every place else as a white married woman with a child. So that's what I want, and we're still not there yet. Who else wants to go now with their idea on that one? Stu, maybe it looks like you're prepared to say something, are you?
Am I?
I just saw you going green on there.
Women with children also have a long ways to go too. Don't my sisters probably agree with that, but I was struck with what TJ said about the 80s and how we lost a lot of people back then. And I was thinking about my friends who survived, and I survived, and how now, you know, most of those people who, you know, got through that crisis are living into their later years with HIV, and very few people to take care of them when the crunch time comes, because we lost our support group back then. And our latest project is about social isolation and loneliness, and looks at a lesbian couple, for example, in remote Alaska, who, because of their income disparity of women, face, and their small support group face, you know, homelessness. So I think we're on our, pessimistically, I'm going to say we're on our own as we age. Optimistically, I'm going to say we are the most adaptable cohort as far as older people goes. I mean, research proves that. So we just need to keep our activism up into our and why not? That sounds like a lot of fun, actually. Let's do that.
Okay, let's do that.
Well, who wants to go next? I'll go. It's like living this long was an adventure, and we are heroes of our own stories, and we can take that heroism toward the future. I'm probably the oldest person here. I don't feel old. I don't think I look as old as I am. But, you know, I'm facing, people are sort of saying, are you still working? It's like, yeah, I'm still working. I'm still thinking I can do my work. I love my work. Then we're in a big house with a lot of stairs. What do we do now? Do we, you know, get rid of the stairs, build an elevator, or move to something that has a few less staircases, with, you know, less space? But our place is gorgeous and we have views of San Francisco. And yet we're talking about downsizing and also getting out of the wind. So all of these things are because of age. You know, mm-hmm. In the last 2 years, I have had two major surgeries, a huge back surgery and a hip surgery. And I'm walking around, I'm okay. And I do the stairs, they're okay. Going up, going down is a little more difficult. You're sort of thinking about it much of the time. And at the same time, it's like, I've made it this far, you know, and you can't complain about being old because you're here and some friends have died. Right. Or many, I mean, in different communities, certainly a whole, you know, whole swath of friends and relatives, you know, disappeared. I've lost a couple of really wonderful women friends and former lovers to breast cancer. And, you know, I sort of, when their birthdays come around, I think to myself, I know it's like 25 years ago, and I've had 25 years since then to do what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's scary, and I also feel that we have the means, individually and then collectively, because we're working very well collectively. San Francisco has a place called Open House now that is both a living and a resource center and meeting center and art center, and you can eat lunch there, you know, and it's just, it took a long time to get off the ground, and it's affordable. When people talk about affordable in San Francisco, nobody else can afford it. But you know, it's there for people, and there are certainly people who need all of those things. I have a lot, and I'm very grateful for it. And yet, there's a whole, you know, many people who don't, and that's where we need to get housing and all kinds of things in place. And you know, working on it, but it's just the slowest thing to, you know, it's like watching housing go up for the poor, you know, there are other poor, is like watching paint dry. So that's all I have to say.
Okay, who next? Who wants to go next? Sid, David, TJ?
Well, I might just comment, so much, you had my mind spinning, because so much of what you have lived with, I didn't live with. I lived with it theoretically. I was always about social justice. I came out late. And so I was much easier to fight for other people than it was for myself. I find myself now in a situation that maybe I am fighting for my future. I'm not quite there yet. But I would say, as much as we have come so far, and I love the fact there are progressive areas, I really worry about those areas that are not progressive. And Phoenix is not a progressive area. We are a little island in the midst of it, and we have a long way to go. But I look at the folk who are coming in here. I'm not necessarily the most out person, but I wear rainbows. I wear mask. And the reason I do that is culturally, I want staff and residents to be really, really clear about who we are and who we accept. And I still believe it's true to this day. If you can embrace the LGBT equal movement and see them equal in God's eyes, a lot of the other isms are also eradicated at the same time. And it becomes kind of a litmus test for how truly inclusive you are. And we do fight that. My biggest concern will probably be, and I ran a PFLAG helpline and it raised my awareness, is probably the trans community. I think that we may have made progress in some areas, but I had a call for a 28-year-old, and we're seniors, 28-year-old who could not find, she needed to go into skilled nursing. and they actually knew that we were friendly and wanted to know if we would accept a 28-year-old trans woman. And the answer was automatically yes, but I said, listen, she's going to be the youngest by 60, 70 years. This may not be the right setting for her to flourish in. Well, word came back to us. She said that would be the all I want to be is safe. Now that's looking at skilled nursings across the valley, and it just, it crushed me. So she was more than willing. I say, well, what you will have is a whole bunch of grandparents who will be watching out for you. And I knew the staff would be good. I did run up really quickly, and we held a quick meeting to make sure, because I wanted everything to be perfect, because she was scared. And had a beautiful meeting, except for one staff person was absolutely obnoxious. I was horrified by the words she was saying. And I'm going, how did this person get into this community as a staff person? Afterwards, I watched another nurse come up to her and show her a picture. And she said, and just said, this is my son. Isn't he beautiful? And this CNA said, yes, he's really, really handsome. And then she said, and he was born a she. And her mind just went, and I'd never known this about this staff person. So there's so much more work to be done there. We as a community have worked hard to offer insurance to our trans staff members, but the word needs to get out. And I just say that there's so much work to be done there. I fear for our trans brothers and sisters coming into communities like this. I do think, because of Jen Silent and others, we have made progress, but got a long way to go on the other fronts.
Dave, I would love to come and speak to your staff at some point.
We'd love to have you.
And tell them my story, because I think you're absolutely right. It is all about community, but it's all about, if I could say, education through storytelling, because people are changed through individual stories. Just like, I haven't seen Jen Silent and I really want to see it, mm-hmm. but being a part of Invisible and that film tells the human story. My one person show, Not an Ordinary Life, told my human story of being a woman, you know, blah, 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 getting married, having children, losing a child to cancer, transitioning. You know, when you tell a story, you change minds and hearts.
Agreed.
And so the documentaries, speaking, but we have to do it through our community. I mean, we have to, and the trans thing, as a trans person, you're absolutely right. We are the least understood. And I don't begrudge anybody for not understanding being trans. No one can understand what it's like to be a bereaved parent either, unless you've lost a child.
Been there.
But through our, if we can just keep trying to connect through human to human, and that it is, Helene, one person. It's like watching paint dry. It's one person at a time, you know. Mm-hmm. But I feel like I'm being scattered, but it is through storytelling that we can do this. We can do this, but we have to stay vigilant. We have to stay out there.
Stu, you want to say something?
Yeah, and it's really important for those of you who are watching this to know, and this isn't a planted, you know, statement at all. We aren't able to share those stories without film festivals that are queer specific. Film festivals like Desperado and all those LGBTQ film festivals, queer film festivals that we go to around the country are critical to being able to represent ourselves and the amazing tapestry that we are, that people leave the theater going, I want to be like that, or I feel safe being like that. So, you know, please support film festivals in your community.
Right. We need them back. Physically, they're just not here because of COVID. I saw Jen Silent however many years ago it came out, San Francisco LGBT Film Festival. It was fantastic.
TJ, you want to kind of bring us home on this one?
Yeah, I mean, this panel has really had my mind going, because, you know, I mean, I'm an orphan now. You know, my dad's gone, my mom's gone, my brothers and sisters are gone. I'm married, mm-hmm. though. I have a husband. But I do sit and think about it. Like, what happens if Tom goes first, then what happens to me? You know, and he's got a couple of nieces. And, you know, these are things I never thought about. And, you know, my mother died of Alzheimer's. So, you know, that was the long goodbye. So I wonder what happens if that happens to me? Or I think, you know, Stu mentioned the loneliness and the isolation. We are very good at building community when we're motivated to do so, because we've done that. You know, I can remember a joke that used to say, put a homosexual in a rut and he'll decorate it. Right? I mean, we've done it through the AIDS crisis. You know, we do it all the time. My husband and I moved to Wilton Manors, Florida, for his work. And, you know, it's like the second gayest place in the country per capita. It has the second highest gay population per capita of anywhere else in the country, second only to San Francisco. And there's a lot of senior gay men and gay women there. And I've watched them build community. I think, you know, I'm not ready to go yet. You know, like I'm not ready to wind down. I'm dying with my boots on. But, you know, I saw people in that community do it, and they looked out for each other, and it worked. I think we do need to do more. This is a big issue. And, you know, it's like, as long as there's somebody out there that doesn't have somebody, we know how to love and take care of each other. We need to find a way to do that.
Great. Yeah. I know I've said to my partner, Laurel, more than once, sweetheart, I don't really care about me. I just want you to live one more day than me. Mm-hmm. So that I'm not the one who's alone, because I don't want to be that person.
It's very selfish. I feel the same way.
It's very selfish. I what can I say? But I said it would be best if we died in a car wreck together. I guess that would be. I don't know.
I don't know about a car wreck. Maybe something a little less violent than that.
Violent, right. Yeah, I don't know. But
let's all hope we have at least 20 or 30 more years.
Right? Amen. Oh, yeah,
I do.
Yeah.
I do. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, 30 and 20.
Well, I kind of want to close this up a little, because we're at the hour mark, and I think that one thing is that our futures, that our specific futures in the last 20 or 30 years, how much long you say we have, is really going to be greatly decided by the next generation of LGBTQ people. They're the ones that are, and I see it here in Phoenix. I see them lifting up the banners, and I see them saying, "Let me do that. I can do that." And I hope that happens all over the world and all over the country, and that we all just have a great
life. I think they're more free too, don't you? I think we have our own inhibitions and we hold ourselves back. And mm-hmm. I think that if you're 20 or 30 today, you just mm-hmm. never experienced it. So they're just more, they're just ahead of where we were.
Yeah.
So,
So I hope whatever it is that we've done over these last few years has taught them well, and they're able to, you know, carry the flag on and go forward for us. Well, I just want to say thank you to everyone. This has been amazing. I've learned so much.
It's been wonderful to see how much creativity there is.
Isn't it great? Isn't it great?
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
We ain't dead yet.
Yay. Yay. Okay.
Hey, bye-bye, thank you, everybody. Okay,
great Take meeting care. Everybody.
Okay, bye.
Dave,
bye-bye.
I'm thank serious.
You. We'd love to. We'll get together.
All yeah, right. You'd be wonderful. You do that. It'd be great.
Thanks, later. Everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Helene.
Thanks, Julie.
Bye, Sid. It's great. Come here and visit. I'll take you out to dinner.
All right. You're on.
Yeah, you're on.
Thanks, Sid. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.